countdown. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, blast off!
Transformers! Transformers! All that meets the eye! Transformers! Robots in the sky!
Hi, I'm Flint Dilley, and I was executive story consultant on the Transformer movie, and was a producer on the show, and a story editor, and a writer, and did a lot of Transformer stuff in my day.
I'm Nelson Shandy. I was working as a director for this movie.
Hi, I'm Susan Blue, and I played RC in the movie Transformers.
I'm Tom Griffin, one of the producers of Transformers, the movie, with my partner, Joe Bacall.
Okay, I'm Joe Bacall. I'm also one of the producers with Tom. And I was creative director of Assembo Productions. Tom was the CEO. We've had a great ride together for almost 30 years, and we're still excited about all the things we're doing.
My favorite scene in the movie probably was Starscream kicking Megatron out of Astrotrain. And that's probably because Starscream was my favorite character. I never really liked Megatron very much. And I always loved the dynamic between those two. So I just loved that he had his one moment where, you know, of delusional glory, you know, shortly before he got exterminated.
My favorite scene was the power transformation where Hot Rod becomes Rodimus Prime and he has that jolt of power and heroic commitment and even a touch of maturity that we all like.
My favorite scene was one of the early scenes, was really when Optimus Prime arrives and transforms from the truck to do battle, which turns out to be his final battle against Megatron. But the rush of you've got the touch, you've got the power, as he's coming in on that truck and makes this transformation and then confronts Megatron, that's my favorite scene. My son Jay Bacall, who was actually a supervising producer on the film, he came up with the name Transformers. And we presented it to the client, and they liked it, you know, but that Stephen had a question. He was worried initially that people would think that the Transformers, well, that was something that you had to plug into the wall, that a kid was going to be asked to plug this into the wall. And we said, no, they're going to think it's just what we want them to think, which is that it's something that changes from one form to another. And his team was really supportive of it, and finally said, okay, that's the name, let's roll, you know. So it was great. It was really exciting.
The Stephen that we're talking about was Steve Hassenfeld. He was leader of Hasbro in the early days. When we started working with Hasbro, it was a really small company.
I like the Megatron, gigantic guy, you know, Megatron. He turned into the smaller gun. Then Starscream, he grabs, you know, and shooting at the Autobots. That's what we like, yeah.
Well, my favorite character of the Transformers is Optimus Prime.
And my favorite character was Blur.
Absolutely, positively, definitely, nobody can get the job done faster than I can. Nobody.
John Machida played Blur. He was the fastest talking person in history, I believe, and you could still understand him. I always liked the idea that someone could talk that fast and you really could follow them, and so that was one I loved.
If I could be a Transformer, I think I would transform into...
maybe one of the airplane, maybe?
Boy, I don't know. I transform into a computer that worked or something like that.
Because I want to just overlook, you know. I mean, looking down, you know, somewhere.
A really souped up car.
You know, a walking word processing unit or a game design machine or something.
A really souped up car that didn't take any gasoline whatsoever.
It would be fun to be a Dinobot.
And I could go anywhere, you know, without any kind of fuel.
Yeah, it'd just be really stupid and break stuff.
Yeah, but really pretty. Probably real pretty pink.
Some character maybe could make a difference in this world we live in, which is in difficult shape right now. I don't know.
That's a good answer. The music was different than films than animated films had done for the time. We did set out to set a different tone, because television series have a bed of music, and we had a great Transformers theme, which was loved and is you know, still popular today, but we wanted to reach differently into a broader music arena.
Right, and that's why we wanted a rock group. Lion was an emerging rock group at that time. We wanted them to record the Transformers theme. And we had a really terrific, Bill Ring, a terrific music supervisor who was part of the Scotti Brothers Company. And they, you know, he was terrific in terms of he knew all these different people, Stan Bush, and who sang You've Got the Touch, You've Got the Power, and Dare, and everything like that. And so he knew all these people, and he had a good instinct for what the best song would be for different sections of the movie. But we wanted to broaden the audience, and that was really the key thing, as Tom was saying. And we felt that having a rock score would do that.
As a woman, I can do a little kid's voice, and where guys grow up and their voices get lower, we kind of always just stay right here, you know, so I can do like a little boy, or I can do a little girl, or I'm kind of all over the place, you know. It's, you can play, what's great is you can play a baby and then an ancient person all in the same day. Oh, I think she'd be incredibly strong, Mrs. Optimus Prime. She'd be very caring. She'd be very demanding. Be great. I'd love to play Mrs. Optimus Prime. If I was Mrs. Megatron, I think she'd be in here, and she'd be very, a little more gravelly, you know, and a little bit more with a bite, a little more sinister. I think my favorite part of voice acting as a career is the actual sessions, you know.
We recorded a lot of times differently than they're used to doing cartoons, in that we do things in ensemble.
It's wonderful to go into an ensemble cast and you've got five people on your left who are geniuses and five people on your right who are geniuses that can do anything with their voices.
And they had a thing called perfect pause in those days, and that was, you put a second between every line of dialogue.
You know, it's fun to watch somebody like Frank Welker play off of somebody like Michael Bell, to play off of somebody like Peter Cullen.
But in that second, they wouldn't have to animate anything. So if you take every line of dialogue in the show, you'd save a minute or 2 minutes per show of animation. And, you know, it's kind of like this scam. I don't know who invented it, but the minute you got rid of perfect pause, the shows just started to come alive, and it felt like it felt like more of a real theatrical production.
I remember we were doing a session, and this one guy went, "Yeah, come on!" And we heard this like rip, and his pants had ripped because he did this huge kind of Wallace sound, you know, especially when you're fighting. Ha, 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 you know, and all of a sudden we hear this cloth rip, and it was one of the actors whose pants had ripped in the session. Well, we were like laughing, crawling out of the booth. We were laughing so hard, and the poor guy, you know, it was great.
You know, it was groundbreaking to introduce these famous actors in an animated feature, because at that time, mostly, not famous, but good actors were voicing the different animated characters in feature films. But we wanted, again, to have a point of difference, you know, to really step up. And we thought that would, in addition to having the voice actors, the terrific voice actors like Peter Cullen and Frank Welker, do the characters that they had been doing on the TV show. For the new characters we were creating, we wanted to have some stars. The expletive, let's talk about that for a second, right? The expletive in the film, when Spike, in a moment of panic, in the midst of this battle, yells out, "Oh, shit!" That was in the script. That was in the script. It wasn't ad-libbed or anything like that, because he wasn't in any panic in the recording studio. And But there was a big controversy about that. There was such a big controversy that, in fact, when the VHS came out, they took it out. And then I think somebody prevailed, some more level head prevailed, and said, don't do that. Come on, the world is changing. Just put it back. And, of course, it went back into the DVD, and I'm sure it's in this version that's been remastered, because it makes sense. I mean, that's a moment of panic. That's not going to shock anybody in the world.
It was also in, though, to make it clear that our rating level would not be a G, which would limit our audience, would cut back on the number of people who at that time would go to see an animated film, and just raise it that little bit a notch. And in that sense, it was probably one of the many decisions, like the music and like the casting, that we made to try to elevate the broad age appeal of the film.
And I think that it definitely was, because the G.I. Joe film was initially finished, or almost finished, was certainly at rough cut stage, with Duke dying. And then there was a big discussion, a big meeting about it, and a feeling after all the letters and from parents and everything like that, that Duke should live. And so, but we'd already done all the animation. So you can see, when you see the G.I. Joe movie, everybody is around, and all of a sudden, the call comes in on a walkie-talkie. Yes, yes, Duke's alive. He's recovered. He's come out of his coma.
So yeah, the writers, there was just this constant churn of stuff. And what was really funny is things would bleed from G.I. Joe into Transformers. Like there's a woman, I think her name's Marissa Fairborn, who is Flint and Lady J's daughter, turns up in, I think, in Five Faces of Darkness, which is a Transformers. There was Hector Ramirez, who was kind of our Geraldo Guevara, character who would show up in, you know, would show up in all of our different shows. He'd always be the news guy.
Yes, we're a little surprised, but not surprised at the same time. I mean, the thing is, we said it in the future, 2005. Now this is 2006. So in a sense, we obviously weren't thinking about that it was going to be last and become a big cult success or anything like that. We were just trying to do the best film we could with the story we had to tell. So I don't think that we were thinking about that. So
the fact that Transformers has had a long life is not really a surprise to us, I don't think. Although you step back and think it's been 20 years and you say, wow. But at the heart of Transformers is empowerment to children and control of their world, learning about their world, fantasy, play, good versus evil, mastery, and all those are really classic story adventure elements that are part of growing up and part of being a child and part of becoming a responsible adult. And I think that the heart of Transformers, you know, is probably going to be around forever.
No. I cannot sing the theme song to Transformers.
Transformer.
More than meets the eye.
Transformer.
Robots in disguise.
That was the one thing that they all remembered, you know, it was robots in disguise. And of course, it was the heart of what the concept was. So it was great.